Hello and welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to a new edition of the Daily Debate. In tonight's show, we're going to be tackling a few files, the first of which will be President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi inaugurating three units of electricity generating in West Asyut Power Station. That happened today, along with other projects that he inaugurated via video conference earlier today. Also, we're going to talk about the Nakba Day, which is the May 15th of every year. Over the past 68 years, the Palestinians have commemorated their collective exile from Palestine. Also, we're going to shed light on the Yemeni government actually suspending its participation in talks with the Houthi rebels on Tuesday, the second time this month, in a new setback to the UN-backed peace process. And joining us here in the studio to shed more light on these issues is Ambassador Dr. Samir Borhan, former Assistant Foreign Minister. Ambassador Dr. Borhan, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you very much, Sam.
Ladies and gentlemen, before we start our conversation, let's check out this report regarding President Sisi inaugurating the three units for electricity generation in West Asyut Governorate, and we'll be right back.
President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi inaugurated on Tuesday three units of electricity production at the new Asyut power plant. The new eight-unit combined cycle power plant, at the cost of $746 million, is expected to produce about 1,000 megawatts. Meanwhile, President al-Sisi inspected on Tuesday the new Asyut barrage project and its hydroelectric station, which aims to improve the irrigation system in Upper Egypt. The project will be fully operational by September 2017. During the next 7 months, more power plants will operate at a total investment of £20 billion. In June 2015, former Prime Minister Ibrahim Mahlab had inaugurated three units of the plant, which was jointly established by Egyptian company and American General Electric Company on a total area of 85 acres, consisting of eight generating units. Each generates 125 megawatts. Minister of Electricity Mohammed Shaker said the project has been completed in a time record, which is 5 months and a half. During the duration with the majority of Egyptian labor. A combined cycle power plant conserves fuel efficiently, as blackouts in Egypt had been attributed to lack of fuel operating regular power plants. Shaker said Asyut power plant is part of Egypt's 2015 plan to overcome electricity shortages, which includes adding 3,632 megawatts to the country's power grid with an investment cost of around $2.65 billion. The inauguration was attended by ministers of electricity, local development, sports, health, social solidarity, irrigation, transportation, and housing.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, and starting off our debate tonight, we're going to have this phone call by Ambassador Gamal Bayoumi, the Secretary General of the Arab Investors Union. Hello, Ambassador Bayoumi, can you hear us?
Yes, of course. Good evening.
Good evening, sir. Ambassador Bayoumi, now, President Sisi inaugurated these three units of electricity production at the new West Asyut power plant. How do you view this project? Is it a timely project? Do you feel that this is part of the grand plan of actually renewing and strengthening the energy sector here in Egypt? Do you feel that this will affect the electricity shortages that we've been experiencing here since 2008, actually?
Let me tell you, on the personal level, I am one of the happiest Egyptians today, because I belong to an electricity family. My grandfather used to generate electricity in Ras El Bar up till 1960. And I know the details of what do you need in order to generate electricity. And really, I admire what the Egyptian government and President Sisi are doing concerning the power in general and electricity in especially. Mm-hmm. Now, no more circuit problems, no more problems during the night, especially in the heat temperature nowadays, and we need to use electricity. Also, electricity for the industry, for generating other products and so on. Mm-hmm. And it's quite clear that President Sisi decided to jump over this problem totally. Now we are talking about electricity generated by the classic way, thermal, and this is the one he inaugurated today, is one of the largest power stations in the world, in this, of this sort. We are talking also about the nuclear energy in North Egypt, in Al-Baba. And I was following this project since the 80s, and I decided to buy it immediately from the Germans. I hope this also can take place. Mm-hmm. So I feel happy, really, not only satisfied as Egyptian and as a man who spent most of his life in this area of production in Egypt, the energy, which is very important for any sort of activity in our economic life.
Mm-hmm. Ambassador Bayoumi, now the President stressed that concerning the nuclear Dabah power plant, he actually emphasized the security measures that will be implemented at that plant. But do you feel that there's still a long way to go before such a plant becomes operational and we can actually see the fruit, bear the fruit of the nuclear power plant?
I don't think it would take much time, because we were ready in 1980. And there are sort of consultancy companies were helping us from Switzerland and other countries. And I was inside this deal with Germany, but Chernobyl came and stopped it. So I think as sort of experience, we have the experience. But now you are coming to enter in the what we call the fourth generation of nuclear energy, which may be a sort of addition to what we know. So I am quite confident that our experts are in a position to decide. Firstly, it depends on seeing what offers we can have and which the best financial offer, because finance also is very important to take the decision. Mm-hmm. Things must be maintained in your mind. One, the quality of the energy or the nuclear reactor which is offered to us. Second, how it's going to be financed. A third, security matter, that the fuel, this is a subject nobody is talking about, that we should, in order to make a decision to buy a nuclear energy reactor, that we should make the fuel ourselves. Are not going to import fuel from anywhere. The problem here that they deny that countries which own nuclear energy power station to maintain or to produce their own fuel. We should insist to produce our full fuel and not to import it. Otherwise, there shall be always captures to somebody outside this country.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Ambassador, now this project, the electricity generating and the power generating projects, will actually be fully operational by September of 2017. So it's not really this year. We'll have to wait for another year for it to be fully operational. Do you think that we might be facing energy problems or electricity shortages and outages until it is fully operational next year?
Yeah. 2000 is very soon for a size of a power station like that. But up till then, we are talking about something like 1 year or more. Mm-hmm. You know that we are establishing the electric net among the Arab countries, coming from Baghdad, connecting Kuwait and the Saudi and the Gulf state with Egypt, then to Libya, Tunisia, Algeria, and Morocco. It is a huge dream concerning energy also, where you save 30% of your energy, because when Baghdad is sleeping now, because Baghdad is ahead of us by 3 hours, we are now in the peak of using energy. So I think that we are sort of try to enlarge our capacity of energy from different sources, whether it is the oil or nuclear. Or, by the way, you called me, I'm in the middle of a meeting discussing the solar energy also, which can have a good future in this country.
Mm-hmm. Ambassador Gamal Bayouni, Secretary General of the Arab Investors Union, thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador, for joining us. Now, Ambassador Dr. Borhan, not getting into details of this project, but it seems that this is part of the mega project that the presidency has been stressing on for quite some time, talking about generating electricity and generating energy, working on the nuclear power plant, trying to work on fossil fuels, also the extraction of gas from the Mediterranean. But we're also talking about many other mega projects at the same time simultaneously, whether if it's the administrative capital, the agricultural sector as well. Where, in terms of priority, do you feel the mega projects related to the energy sector should be placed among all these mega projects?
This is only my personal point of view. I think if we generate electricity either from many sources, solar energy, wind energy, waterfalls energy, or electricity from fossils or whatever it is, or petroleum. I think we should serve the people, because we have suffered last summer and the summer before from high heated atmospheres, and the plants, I mean electrical plants, were not able to cover all the priority needs of the people. I think if we just put for a priority for serving the interests of the people for electricity, I think this is should be taken into consideration by the Ministry of Electricity and Energy and other ministries which has interest in the fund. We should put in before our eyes the interests of the people, and we are so our summer is very heated, it's very hot, and we should be able to acclimatize ourselves with the government of Egypt, which is in changeable, I think.
Yes. Do you feel that these projects would be considered part of the projects to actually renovate the Egyptian infrastructure?
Of course. I think this is one of the major interests of the government and of our president at the moment, that to establish our infrastructure and renovate our infrastructure in various sectors, among which is electricity, of course. Mm-hmm. So I think it is most important to renovate and re-establish our powers in the electricity and in other fields. So I think this is a very good step from the government, and I think if the government continue in that direction, I think she will have the consent of the people.
Yes. Well, Ambassador Dr. Borhan, now during the inauguration of today's project, the president also spoke about the Palestinian-Israeli issue, and the Nakba Day, the 15th of May, really still another day that highlights the importance of such an issue for the Middle East and the world, as a matter of fact. Now, in today's statements by the president, he stressed that the Palestinians and the Israelis should seize the opportunity to actually resume the peace negotiations, and Egypt will do all what it can do, all the efforts that it can exert for the Palestinians and Israelis to actually find some common ground and go back to the 1979 Egyptian-Israeli peace treaty as some sort of a reference. Do you feel that there is a room or a new option to be offered for the Palestinian-Israeli conflict?
Let us discuss it in a broad sense, because we commemorate in this month two most important events. Mm-hmm. The first of which is the Sykes-Picot Agreement, which was the basis for dismantling the Middle East after the Ottoman Empire has fallen. Mm-hmm. This is one thing. And it was the artificial borders, which has been planned between England and France to reshape the Middle East into modern Arab countries, whatever it is. On the other hand, this is the Nakba. It is not a Nakba. It is a disaster or catastrophe. Mm-hmm. Because it is a most vicious event which has happened to the Palestinian people since 60 years, as you have already said. But let us discuss it in other terms. I think if we the agreement between Egypt and Israel has stood for 30 years now, from 1979 up till this moment, nearly 30 years, and the other agreement between Israel and so if we, and we have at our hands the Prince Fahd and re-established by Prince Abdullah or King Abdullah of Saudi Arabia to have entire peace with the Arab world, with Israel, in verses of Israeli withdrawal from all Arab territories and give the Palestinian people its rights to determine their future. And we have at hand also the theory of two states in the Middle East, in the Palestine, for Israel, for the Israelis and for the Palestinians. So I think on the model of the agreement between Egypt and Israel, we can have another agreement between Israel and the Palestinians, conditioned that the Israelis are willing to go to that road. I think, in my humble opinion, the Israelis up till this moment have not shown their flags, real mm-hmm. flags, if they wanted peace or they wanted just to keep the territory. They can't have the two together. Mm-hmm. They can't have peace and keeping the territories, occupied territories from 1967 or at the moment. So they have the people of the Israel has to choose either to keep the territories or to keep peace. Yes. And if we have listened to the reason, and if he hasn't listened to the intelligent people of Israel, I think they may, and I hope they may go for the option of peace.
Mm-hmm. Well, ladies and gentlemen, let's check out regarding the Palestinians commemorating 68 years since the Nakba Day, and we'll be right back to continue our discussion.
Palestinians commemorated the commemoration activities of the 68th anniversary of Nakba in the occupied West Bank, Gaza Strip, the 1948 occupied territories, and in the diaspora. 15th of May marks the anniversary of the displacement of the Palestinian people from the original town in historical Palestine, where the Jews settled in Palestine since then and set up their own super entity through dozens of massacres that claimed the lives of thousands of Palestinians over the years of conflict. Sirens were sounded for 68 seconds in various Palestinian cities to usher in the activities of the 68th anniversary of Nakba. And the National Islamic Forces in Gaza participated in a mass march to commemorate the anniversary, which cannot be forsaken. Hundreds of Palestinians in the city of Nablus in the northern West Bank participated in the march of return to commemorate the Nakba University. The march began from Faisal Street, headed by the return ship, a symbolic ship boarded by Palestinian children in the Palestinian traditional dress to show their attachment to the right of return to their ancestral homeland. Participants in the march raised the Palestinian flag, symbolic keys of their original houses they left forcibly, and the names of Palestinian towns and villages from which their grandfathers were forcibly expelled in 1948. They also chanted slogans expressing their attachment to the right of return and refusal of settlement. The march ended with a rally in organized by the Supreme National Committee to commemorate the Nakba Day. The festival also included a number of events, including chanting the oath of return, refusal of resettlement, and alternative projects. In a speech of the National Committee and factions and institutions, Jihad Ramadan said that the Nakba will remain a blot on the conscience of humanity. He said massacres that happened during the Nakba exceed the Nazi war crimes. He stressed the right of return and compensation according to the International Resolution number 194, which is not in favor from anyone, but is a right that will never be expired.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Before we continue our discussion regarding the Nakba Day and the Palestinian-Israeli issue, we're joined now over the phone by Mr. Mohammed Sobki, consultant to the Ministry of Energy. Hello, Dr. Sobki, can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear you.
Dr. Sobki, first of all, the inauguration of today's power and electricity generating units in Osyut Governorate by the President. Now, this project will be fully implemented in September 2017. Do you feel that we might be facing problems until it is fully operational, or does it mean that it will be operational but at 100% capacity it will be operational in September next year?
Well, no. I mean, yes, it will be 100% operational, and according to the program of the Ministry of Electricity and Renewable Energies, the expansion, the generation expansion plans are going according to schedule, and that means that we will be able to face the increasing demand on electricity. And I don't anticipate facing any cutouts or something like that due to any lack of generation capacity. Of course, that also rely very much on the availability of fuel, natural gas. In addition, that the Ministry of Electricity and Renewable Energies are working very hard on expanding on the use of renewable energies, where there is an aggressive program to reach, according to what was today, to reach 20% of the electricity mix by year 2022, to reach 20% of our electricity mix from renewable energies as well.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Sophia, should we expect with the availability of more energy, electricity, should we expect maybe lower energy and electricity prices, or should we at least expect it to stay the same, especially as you've mentioned, well, you will need a lot of fuel to generate these plants. So does that mean that we might be facing an increase in the prices of fuel, or some shortage of any sort for the fuel and gas?
There is one thing is, the Ministry of Electricity and Renewable Energy have announced in July 2014, a plan to reform the electricity tariff in order to be able to cover the cost of generation by all types of generators, and actually also this might go a little bit more. This tariff reform might extend not to 2019 but up to 2021 in order to cover the real cost of generation. That includes the cost of generation, that includes the cost of the capacity of the hardware, as well as the cost of the fuel. Mm-hmm. So we expect that the tariffs will remain in their increasing up to year 2021.
Yes. Dr. Sobki, regarding the Daba nuclear power plant, now Russia will offer a loan to Egypt to help finish this project within 7 years. Has Moscow already decided the first tranche of the loan?
It's in the process to do that. the process has started already, and we should expect that to happen very soon. And the plans are going really on a fast rate in order to fulfill the target of building this nuclear power plant in Dabha to schedule. Of course, that will, that diversity of supply of electricity will mean, I would say, a sustainable availability of the electricity and not depending on one type of fuel. That's quite positive in a way to ensure the availability of electricity to all our needs and economical activities, industrial as well, commercial and residential.
Dr. Mohammed Asoki, the consultant to the Ministry of Energy, thank you very much for joining us this evening. Ambassador Dr. Borhan, now talking about the Nakba Day and the Palestinian-Israeli issue, do you feel that with all the political developments that took place over the past few years throughout the Arab world, do you feel that now the negotiating table is not really as balanced as it was before? Because during the negotiations, prior to all the developments that took place over the past 5-6 years, it was always that the Palestinians had the backing and the weight of all the Arab countries and all the Arab governments supporting it in these negotiations, namely Egypt as well. Do you feel that now, with all the turbulences, do you feel that there will be any sort of change in the dynamics within any peace negotiations between both sides?
Let us, put our hands on facts. I think the balance between the Israelis and the Palestinians has never been in their favor, in Palestinian favor, because Israel has the territory, and this is a material and substance in their hands. And feel that if they just give the Palestinians its territory, they may be threatened by the Palestinians and the other Arab countries. This is one thing. The other thing, this integration of which is happening in many Arab countries as around Israel, Syria, Iraq, and some other distant countries like Libya and Yemen, and Saudi Arabia as well. So I think this is put put more elements in favor of Israel and disfavor for the Palestinians and the Arabs on the other hand. So I think the imbalance between the two powers, the Palestinians and the Israelis, is quite clear at present. And I don't think that if the Palestinians go to the negotiations at the moment with this balance at hand, I think they will get trifles or to get nearly nothing from the Israelis. Mm-hmm. And it has been cleared up by Netanyahu, as he has announced that he has got the Golan Heights forever, and it will not be returned to Syria. And it has, I think, has some kind of Knesset meeting in the Golan Heights. Mm-hmm. This is a clear sign and a signal to the Arabs that the Israelis are adamant in occupying the territories, and they will not return these territories unless they are coerced by high powers. Either the power of the United States, which I think will not exercise that powers, or the powers of the Arabs themselves. And we see how the Arabs are at the moment. Mm-hmm. They are not in a good shape to coerce Israel to give concessions.
Yes. Well, you've mentioned earlier that if we're going to go to a two-state solution, that means that the Israelis will actually have to give up some of the settlements and some of their land as well. What are the chances of this actually happening? What needs to happen for the Israelis to approve of that? And both states would be side by side, a two-state solution. Is that even possible?
Unless the United States, which has pronounced this two states solution in the Palestinians, coerce the Israel or put pressure on the Israel to implement that solution, I think the Israelis will not implement it at all. Mm-hmm. Because the Israelis are quite happy by the situation at the moment. The Arabs or in the Arab states around them are disintegrating, and the Arabs are less and less stronger than they were before, and the Europeans are not exercising any pressure at all on the Israelis, and the United States is standing still at the moment, and now President Obama is about to finish his new term, second term, and I think why the Israelis have to give concessions to the Palestinians at this moment. Mm-hmm. If I were Mr. Netanyahu, I shall wait and see how things is going to develop.
Mm-hmm. Well, if the U.S. administration is really one of the main in such, or the United States actually has a great influence on such negotiations, and the next move that would be taken by the Israelis, what would make the United States administration push for a peace negotiating process? What would make the U.S. opt or try and force or influence the Israeli side to agree on a two-state solution?
I think, in my opinion, or my modest opinion, that the United States will not exercise real power upon Israel. Mm-hmm. They are waiting to see, and the situation is deteriorating in the Arab countries. The Americans are having their foot in the Arab worlds, in Israel, in Iraq, Syria, and in other places, and they are quite happy by that situation. Unless the situation is, or the table is overlapped upon them, they will not go for a real move for peace. Mm-hmm. This is quite clear to the, and this is why the European has left their hand out of the negotiations, or out of meddling in the Middle East, or meddling in the Palestinian issue. Mm-hmm. So I think the United States is unwilling to pressure Israel, and the Israelis are quite happy by the situation they are in at the moment. They have the territories in their hand. They are building more settlements in the Arab world. They are reshaping the geopolitics situation on the ground. So why they should give a concession to the Arabs, or in particular to the Palestinians? Mm-hmm. I think unless the Arab world is to stand up and to reshape itself, and to see the real danger, and to see who are their friends and who are their enemies, I think the situation is more deteriorated than ever.
Mm-hmm. Your Excellency, now Egypt has been always playing a major role in the Palestinian-Israeli file, whether if it's mediating between the Israeli and Palestinian sides, whether if it's actually mediating or playing a reconciliatory role between the two Palestinian factions. But now, how do you see, as the President mentioned earlier today, that Egypt will exert all its efforts and all the possible energy and the opportunity to actually push for a peace process between both sides? How do you think it will be different this time around, the role played by Egypt?
This is our high hopes. Mm-hmm. But if we look at the facts, the Israelis have not invited us to take a role or to meddle in the Middle East, neither the Palestinians. Nobody, the two parties has never invited Egypt to take a chance. This is our hopes. mm-hmm. that we can middle, we are offering our service as a middleman, but are they really want us to be a middleman?
This is why the don't they want us now?
I mean, this is the question. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think because the situation now in favor of Israel. So why Israel invite Egypt to be a middleman between them and the Israelis and the Palestinians?
Mm-hmm.
If they invited Egypt, I think they have to give concessions to Egypt just to give to the other party. This is one thing. And the other thing, now the Palestinians, who are the Palestinians? Hamas or Mahmoud Abbas.
Mm-hmm.
So neither Mahmoud Abbas, neither the Hamas have invited us, or I wanted Egypt mm-hmm. to meddle in or to play a role at a middleman between them themselves and the Israelis.
Mm-hmm.
So I think this situation is more complicated, is it? The more complex, and I can't see that peace will ever happen in my time.
Mm-hmm. Ambassador Dr. Borhan, now you explained why the Israelis didn't really invite Egypt for a role in this process. But what about the Palestinians? How would you describe the relationship between the Egyptians and the Palestinians over the past few years?
The Palestinians are not one body.
Mm-hmm.
They are mainly two bodies and even four or five bodies. We have Hamas, we have Mahmoud Abbas, we have the Popular Front, and the Popular Front Central Committee or whatever it is of Ahmed Gibril. So I think who are the Palestinians who will have the courage to invite Egypt to take a part in the negotiations if we are accepted by the other side as well, mm-hmm. I mean the Israelis. So let us, and Hamas is, I mean, has doubts that Egypt is behind Mahmoud Abbas, and the other factions is also saying that Mahmoud Abbas is a traitor.
Mm-hmm.
Because he has security arrangements between, the government of Mahmoud Abbas in Ramallah and the Israelis. So a great faction mm-hmm. of the Palestinians look at Mahmoud Abbas as a traitor.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So why Egypt should meddle in this quagmire,
mm-hmm.
which is not one body?
Yes. Well, ladies and gentlemen, these are not the only developments taking place in the region. Also, the world powers are ready to supply Libya with weapons and ammunition to counter the terrorists already there. Let's check out this report and we'll be right back.
States and other world powers expressed their readiness to supply Libya's internationally recognized government with weapons to counter Daesh and other terrorist groups. The decision was stated in a statement at top-level talks on Libya in Vienna. It was signed by the U.S. and four other permanent U.N. Security Council members. And more than 15 other nations participating at the talks said they are ready to respond to the Libyan government's requests for training and equipping government forces. German Foreign Minister Frank-Walter Steinmeier said it was still unclear if the government of National Accord, which sailed into Tripoli on March 30th, would be able to end the bloody chaos that Libyans have endured since Muammar Gaddafi's fall 5 years ago. He said the decisive question is whether Libya, directly on Europe's southern border, remains a place where terrorism, the crime of human trafficking and instability keep spreading on, or whether we and the GNA will be able to restore stability and rule of law. For his part, French Foreign Minister Harlem Désir warned that Daesh is a threat not only to Libyans and the wider region, but also to Europe. U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry, during a brief press appearance with a Jordanian counterpart, Nasser Judah, said major powers had a lot of work to do. The conference focused on the flow of illegal immigrants from Libya to Europe after a damning report from the British Parliament suggested last week that an EU naval mission to combat people trafficking was failing. A total of 25 diplomats were in attendance, including UN Special Envoy to Libya Martin Kobler and the EU Foreign Policy Chief Federica Mogherini. The Vienna conference was being co-chaired by the US and Italy, Libya's former colonial ruler, which has faced a major influx of migrants from the nation, braving the perilous sea voyage. Daesh has taken advantage of the chaos and left by the toppling and death of Muammar Gaddafi, which has led to rival militants vying for control of the country.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Your Excellency, now this meeting in Vienna between the UN-backed Libyan government and the Western and European powers as well. After the arms embargo imposed by the UN that it was extended over to Libya over the past few years, now this decision to supply this government with weapons and actually a coherent list of what should be and shouldn't be done in order to fight the Daesh terrorists there. Is this, do you feel that this should be seen as now the European leaders and powers and the United States as well as actually passing the torch of responsibility to the Libyan government? Do you feel that the US and the Western European regional powers felt that they didn't really achieve the kind of success that they wanted to achieve, so in a way they want to put the ball in the Libyan government's court? Do you feel that the Libyan government is actually strong enough and well equipped to be able to use these weapons to the maximum potential and actually stopping the advances by Daesh terrorists?
I think this is another very sad story which happens in the Arab world in Libya, because I think this is might be a prelude or an precedent to dismantle Libya for three regions or three states. One in Tobruk, which has connection with Italy. One in Tobruk, which has connection with the East, maybe Egypt and the other. And one in the South, Fezzan, which is have connections with the African countries. So this is, the decision to give weapons to one party. I think this will encourage the other party to have another as a supply of weapons. So that means we are going to, to throw oil on the fire. You see, this is make the fire more stronger and more vibrant. So I think this is very sad story. Unless the Libyan people themselves come together and come to have common interest for their country, and what is also observant for the world is the absence of the Arabs, the absence of the Arab League. Where are the Arab Leagues? The Arab Leagues. Are they happy? The Arab countries and the Arab League happy to see Egypt the disintegration of country like Libya? I think this is a very sad story, because to see the West, to see the Europeans and the Arab Americans have their influence or have their hand, merging the factions in Libya. And the Arabs are absent. The Arab League is absent. I think this is very sad story. We are seeing Egypt, Libya disintegrating
Well,
at the moment.
Mr. Ambassador, now Egypt, along with many Arab countries and other European countries as well, they've all been talking about combating terrorism and actually fighting Daesh and actually taking the war to Daesh if the need arises. So with this happening in Vienna, arming the Libyan government, does this change anything for the plans maybe that countries such as Egypt and other Arab countries have to fight Daesh? Should we expect now that Daesh are there, they have weapons, the government is there, the government has weapons as well, should we expect a bloodier conflict in Libya?
My dear gentlemen, under the banner of terrorism and Daesh and the Jabhat al-Nusra, we have seen Syria disintegrated, we have seen Iraq dismembered, we have seen Libya as well is in the going in the same road. So I think this is under Daesh and the Jabhat al-Nusra is a creation or the child, brainchild of the, sometimes we see the brainchild of the USA, of the Europeans, of the Israelis, who are backing them, or Iran, or whatever. But I think we have the Arabs, we have to reconsider our situation, we have to reunite ourselves, we have to stand as one man to see where the interests, where the differences, we can bridge differences between each other, I think, but we have to see by our own eyes that we are the Arabs, or the Arab countries in the whole division are threatened by outsiders, either terrorism, whatever it is, either by international intervention from various countries, from Russia, from the United States, from the Europeans, whatever it is. But the main interests of the Arabs are at the moment at the stake, in a great danger to see more disintegration in the Arab world.
Yes. Well, talking about disintegration within the Arab world, another war-torn country, Yemen, earlier today, the Yemeni government actually suspended its participation in the talks with the Houthi rebels for the second time this month, which would be considered as a setback for the UN-backed peace process. How should we receive such information about the Yemeni government actually walking out of the talks for the second time in a month with the Houthi rebels?
This is also gives another signal. It is the failure of the Saudi Arabia to support the Yemeni government, because that means that the Saudi campaign in Yemen has failed, and it didn't, I mean, achieve any victory over the Houthiin. And on the other hand, the Yemeni government has taken a step back, because they found that the negotiations with the Houthiin is futile, and the pressure of by this Saudi campaign upon the Houthiin has come to nothing or come to zero. So I think this is quite tactic, policy from the Yemeni government to withdraw from the negotiation at the moment and to reconsider the whole situation. If they are going to have peace agreement with the Houthiin, if they have to combat the Houthiin by military power or supported by other countries in the reconsider the situation with Iran itself, because Iran is the main supplier of weapons and the political support of the Houthiin. I think the Yemeni government has to reconsider its policy, where to go to the second step in the negotiations or on the situation as a whole.
And what do you think should be the second step for the Yemeni government? Should they go back to Saudi Arabia asking for another coalition, a military coalition, trying to defeat the Houthi rebels? Should they go to Yemen? Should they ask one way or another? Would they go to Iran? I mean, try and have some sort of a deal with them to influence the Houthi rebels in Yemen?
I think the Saudi, in my modest opinion, the Saudi Arabia and Saudi Arabian campaign against the Houthiin has failed. And the Saudi government of Hadi, government of Mansour Hadi, has to reconsider its situation internally and externally. Internally, they have to extend their hand to the Houthiin to have negotiations inside Yemen to reconsider, and with Abdullah Saleh if possible, to reconsider the situation internally and externally. So they have to extend their hand also to the Iran from one side and Saudi Arabia from the other side. So yeah. I think the economic situation and the military situation and the social situation inside them is very, very poor. Mm-hmm. So they have to reconsider their policy internally and externally.
Mm-hmm. Well, if we look at Iran and Saudi Arabia as the main backers for both sides in Yemen, do you feel that on some level they can reach an agreement, Saudi Arabia and Iran, or is this out of the question?
Not at the moment, because the Saudi Arabian government thinks that they can have the upper hand on the situation in Yemen. But by passing time, I think they should realize that they are going to have great losses in the Yemeni, because Egypt has also its past history in the campaign of Yemen in the 60s of last century, and we lost the war in Yemen, and I think the Saudi Arabians is almost realized that they cannot air attacks, they can eradicate this Hussein from Yemen. No. Mm-hmm.
So how long do you think this conflict could take? Could it be resolved in a few months after intense diplomatic
maybe
ties?
In few years, not months, unfortunately.
Yes. Well, ladies and gentlemen, obviously the Middle East and the Arab world is actually facing a lot of political developments, whether good or bad, within the past few days, also the past few months, and we'll always be following it here on the Daily Debate. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have for this edition of tonight's show. Before we go, I'd like to thank our very distinguished guest, Ambassador Dr. Samir Borhan, former Assistant Foreign Minister. Ambassador Dr. Borhan, thank you very much
thank
for joining
very
us.
Much. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stay tuned for more coming up on Nile International. I'm Hani Saif. Thank you for joining us.